Hello, my friends. I apologize for the slightly delayed start. It's going to be delayed slightly longer as I log into my tablet here so that I can look at the chat and keep up with you all without craning my neck. But I might as well turn on this camera. Colossal Crash, I am very sorry. I'm very sorry, and I understand that I should be. And I hope you can forgive me. How are you doing out there? Thanks for dropping into the stream. I'm gonna continue getting set up over here. We are listening to an extremely creepy song right now. This is another one of our computer/Apple-related tunes. This is from a game called Solid Runner, and this is called Computer. So, this is obviously a tense scene in which a computer is evil, is either evil or is perhaps being accessed and providing the players with some tense information. You're playing FF14? Awesome! How are you liking it? I've only played Final Fantasy VI. 14 is the one with the protagonist with the pink hair, yeah? Lightning? I might be completely wrong. Good morning, Simon! It's always morning where Simon is. I'm almost there. Almost got the chat loaded over here. How are things, Simon? Do 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 do. I've never heard this song before today, and it's already, this bit is already kind of embedded in my brain. Pretty good. Okay, so now I think I can keep up with all of you entities out there. Fantastic! Colossal Crash has been playing it since 2010. And it's the newer online one. I can't tell my Final Fantasies apart anymore. Let's just do a quick test here. Test! And make sure my chat is set up in front of my face. Yay! Okay! We can get started. How about it? Let's do it. It's actually fantasy-based? What is fantasy-based? Colossal Crash. I may not even be listening to the words that I'm saying as I get everything set up. There are many processes running in my brain right now, and the amount of attention allocated to each is not very balanced. Okay. I think we are ready to go. Okay, now I can keep up with you over here. Oh, I can take these off. Woo! Don't need these anymore. All right, friends. Let's see. Simon's giving me the breakdown on the online games. The only one I knew was FF11. I knew that was an online game. Oh, and a new expansion just came out. Pretty cool, Colossal Crash. Well, I hope you're enjoying it. Hey, sir! Sir! How you doing? House of Mule! Hi, users! House of Mule, you still have not disappointed me with a new word. That's fantastic. Okay, so I had hoped that I was going to have a certain surprise for you all tonight on the Apple II. I do not. I have a different surprise, which we'll do at the end. But next week we're going to be doing something particularly interesting. We're going to be kind of kicking it up a notch. So if you're interested in perhaps, well, I don't know which surprise it's going to be. It's going to be some expansion or other for the Apple II. So I will leave that to your imagination. and you could spend all week wondering what it's going to be. But either way, it's going to be really, really excellent. So I hope I see you there, and I hope I get it set up in such a way that it is smoothly running and a wonderful experience. But since I don't have that today, I thought that maybe we would just go back to one of my microzines, because we have been playing a bunch of my cracked games. We've been playing a lot of really interesting but not very action-packed stuff, like the Create with Garfield. That was so much fun. I loved playing that with you all and creating that masterpiece of a surreal painting. That was fabulous. Obviously, Apple Works. And what was the other kind of dry thing that we did? I'm trying to remember. But things like that. So I thought maybe just looking at another microzine today would be a really nice change of pace, because there are extra games on it. There's going to be one big beefy game, and then maybe a medium beefy game, and then little ones. So I think it'll be a nice kind of one-stop shop, and then we can do our surprise at the end of the stream. Oh, E.C. Myers, did I say hi? If I didn't say hi, I'm so sorry. Hello! I'm so glad to see you out there. And also, E.C. Myers, I've been meaning to ask you about the books that you've been writing. Because, folks, if you don't know, E.C. Myers is an author. And I've been seeing a lot of pictures at conventions of E.C. Myers with characters in the books that he's been writing. So I need an explanation. I need to know where to start in the series. Which book should I start with? And just tell me a little bit about what you've been doing, because that's a huge accomplishment. For anyone who's ever tried writing anything, if I finished a fan fiction when I was in high school, I mean, that was, like, such an effort. And that's just a little story. It's not a major novelization. Hey, Kitsarito! So, I'm very interested in all that, and all of you should be, too. Sir says, Key is going to show off her rap battle skills at the end of this stream. Shh! Man, you're just like my friend who ruined the dancing raisins. Alright. So we already did the premiere issue of Microzine. I'll just show this to all of you to remind you of what we did. This was the one with the haunted house game on it. And we were asking that kid from E.T. questions. And we also made that lovely poster of Caterpillar leaving her tree to find a friend. So I'm going to give you a choice now. Womp womp. I'm going to give you a choice real quick. We've got Microzine 13 and Microzine 15. You tell me which one you like better. We've got the dolphin running for president, and we've got a bunch of kids having a fairy tale read to them by a king toad. I'm going to say the first one that gets two or three votes, we're going to go with. So again, I'll just show you. And if you want me to read the stuff on the side, the dolphin microzine includes the game 2088, an Oval Office Odyssey. That's actually the picture you're seeing. That's the game represented there. Keyboarding, so we can do some keyboarding skills, learn how to type. Roundup, a math and strategy game, or Estimator, test your skills at estimation. The Toad game has The Frog and the Fables, a magical story. Again, that's what's represented here. The Secret of the Sphinx, a text adventure. Who's Who in Outer Space, a database of real and imaginary personalities. And The Back Page, which includes a comic strip, puzzles, and more. Speaking of Who's Who in Outer Space, you know what's coming up in a couple days? July 20th. 1969? We landed on the moon, folks. Alright, Kitsarito says dolphin for president. So that's one for dolphin. Simon says 13, lucky number, one for toad. Sir says dolphin. Hey, Gunstar Green. Gunstar Green says dolphin. So the dolphin got three votes first. So we're going to go with microzine number 15. Sorry, E.C. Myers, but when we do Secret of the Sphinx, oh man, I'm going to be excited to do that. That's a text adventure that scared me as a child, and it was the first video game that I wrote my own walkthrough for some reason. I just decided to do it. And I think someone asked me, why did you do that? I just remember somebody being confused by that concept, and since I wasn't publishing it anywhere or giving it to any of my friends, I was kind of like, I don't know. I just wanted to. And also, E.C. Myers was explaining a little bit. The new book is a tie-in to the web series RWBY, so there's a strong fan base with cosplayers aplenty. RWBY, I was seeing mention of Rooster Teeth. Is that something? They must be related in some way. So you're actually, you are writing a tie-in series? So are these your own characters and your own stories that are kind of within the universe of that group of characters? Or what? Rooster Teeth produces the show. Cool! Celebrity in our midst, folks. Let's get Microzine going. This has just the one disc. And I'll show it off, as always, before we get started. Microzine. Scholastic. Oh, and again, for anyone who needs reminders on how to properly handle their diskette care, these are the things that you should not be doing in multiple languages. So if you cannot understand the pictures, there are multiple languages there for you. You have no excuse to not treat your diskettes well, basically. Protect, protéger, and schützen. Yeah, Scholastic is the jam. So Scholastic, Microzine, Scholastic Publishing, E.C. Myers Books, that's fabulous. That's so awesome. All right, let's toss this thing in and get started. Oh, and I'll look at the manual a little bit too. All right. Needs a picture of someone biting the disc. Gunstar Green, did you bite your diskettes? It's kind of like, that makes me think about how, you know, the warnings on everything, do not do this. Those are probably all things that somebody really did do and then tried to pin on the company. So if I ever find a diskette that warns me not to bite it, I know who was the one that tried to raise that lawsuit. Oh, you could hear E.C. Myers? Great. The microphone's actually not on the same side as the disk drives, so sometimes I worry that it doesn't get picked up enough. Let me quickly read a little bit in this Microzine manual that's inside the really nice cardboard case. We don't have the introduction to Microzine. The premiere issue kind of explained what the whole situation was with these discs, but they're supposed to be educational games, and it was a periodical that you would have mailed to your house if you did sign up for it. Not every month, but every few months. And again, I was not a subscriber. These came with my secondhand Apple II. And this is my Apple II from my childhood. So I guess I'll read quickly what these different games are. Oh, why don't we press any key to begin first? E.C. Meyer says, I'm amazed these discs still work. Everyone says that to me. I have never had a disc die. The only discs that I've had trouble with are discs that I've always had trouble with, that I think were not treated well before we got them. So I will be sure to announce my first disc death to you all. But people have been telling me for decades that any day, they're going to die. And they haven't. So maybe I have just been lucky. Hey, don't call me late for dinner. How are you doing? Are you having dinner right now? Don't call me late for dinner. I'm just going to call you for dinner. I like, not just dinner, but for dinner. For dinner says, I failed to convince another streamer that a 3.5-inch floppy disk was not, in fact, a hard drive. I actually worked with someone at a recent job who did not believe that 5.25 floppies were real. They actually thought that, you know, this size disk, they thought that the 5.25 floppy was just the symbol for saving on a computer. They'd never seen one of these in real life. And when we tried to convince them that that was not the case, that it was actually a representation of a real life thing, they didn't believe us. They thought that we were trolling them. Streamception! Hey Red, why is it Streamception? You're sneaking in on you here while Luke is running the show. Oh boy! Let's see. Simon says, why have they not lost their magnetic storage? I thought floppies all had expiration dates just too far out to worry about, which we've only slightly passed now. I don't know. I mean, my parents took very good care of these disks, so that's probably part of it. I've been storing them all in my disk case all of this time, so, you know, sheltered from dust and upright, which is important. Or perhaps I am made of magic. Perhaps I give off a slight, well, I guess I wouldn't want to be giving off a magnetic field. Maybe, oh, I don't know. We'll just say it's magic. Simon, I don't have any of those, alas. E.C. Myers is facepalming. Gunster Green has the CD of OMF, and it is one of your prized possessions. How are you doing, Red? Did I ask that? How's Luke doing? Luke's fishing? Catch a big one, Luke. Sir says, it's weird, but I get so much satisfaction playing my actual childhood consoles on stream. Like, it's cool to make that connection with childhood me and my viewers. There is something, someone said this to me once, I wish I could remember which friend of mine said it, but one of my friends said, there is something magical to firing up an old piece of machinery that still works. And I think that that's very true. I emulate on some of my other streams, and I have no qualms with emulating, as long as you're not emulating, you know, current systems that you have to jailbreak, the really old stuff, but the physical experience of actually running the game on a console or on an old machine is just such a wonderful, wonderful thing. I like to be as kind of close to the machine as I can, I guess you would say, in terms of interacting with it. I'm not really explaining that very well, but the whole experience of the clickety-clack and the yellowing beige, you know, it's great. Okay, so, let's see. Just so you know, we're looking at all the different games here. 2088, an Oval Office Odyssey, a twist-a-plot. Again, this is one of those choose-your-own-adventures that Scholastic branded a twist-a-plot. Will you win re-election as President of the United States? It all depends on how you solve some tough problems facing the United States in the year 2088. The keyboarding, a tutorial, master the art of typing quickly and accurately with this fun and simple tutorial, then play a game with Digit, the robot. Roundup, a math and strategy game. Test your logic skills by throwing lassos to capture the horses and avoid the cacti. If you score enough points, your name will be branded on the high score board. Estimator, a math feature. Estimate the temperature on the thermometer or the time on the clock. Play alone or play with friends to see who is the best estimator. And computer stuff is disk drives, data disks, and printers. Let me see if there's anything else in here. There's more explanations of the games, but I think, you know, I've spent enough time talking. I think we can just dive right into it. Everything else in the manual is just sort of showing you how to play, what to expect. This is the typing game. That's Digit the Robot. Digit is definitely responsible, at least in part, to my 100 words per minute speed of typing. Don't Call Me Dinner says, I have Windows 3.1 on 5 1/4 floppies in your basement. Ooh. Twist-a-plot. Used to love reading those. Were the actual novels called twist-a-plots? Was that actually what they were called? Because I would say to my friends, ooh, have you ever read a twist-a-plot? I love twist-a-plots. And they would not know what I was talking about. Because that was not the word, you know, choose-your-own-adventure or text-adventure kind of came to represent that concept in those different medias. The nostalgia is thick in this stream tonight. Well, I hope it gets thicker, and I hope you all enjoy it. I'm going to go ahead and start 2088, an Oval Office Odyssey. Just real quick before I begin, this was a hugely foundational game in my childhood life. I was playing this game before I could read, so I can distinctly remember sitting in front of the computer and trying so hard to be able to read through these blocks of text to understand what was happening so that I could make choices. And I have such a vivid recollection of how tired I felt mentally, you know? It's kind of like how we feel now as adults sometimes when we try to dive into a really complicated game after a long day of work and you're just like, I'm just so tired in my mind. Not just that I need to sleep, but just I can't do this. I need to have a nap. That feeling was just, it's just a very, very strongly impressed upon me as a moment in my life. So you'll have to imagine, you know, five, six-year-old, bowl-cut, blonde baby Key playing this game and trying really hard and sometimes asking her parents for help with the words. Oh, nice, E.C. Myers. Drop in the twist of plot explanation. I never knew that they were books. I thought that that was just their term for the computer version of a Choose Your Own Adventure. And again, I'm seeing this for the first time in color through my capture card. I'm looking at the computer itself, and we have an amber monitor. I'm going to mention this every stream. We have an amber monitor, so I've only ever seen this in shades of amber until I started streaming my Apple II games, which is so cool. So cool. House Mule says, I've never heard of Twist-a-Plot outside of this stream. Well, you know what we all have to do? We all have to go to our local library. Get some of those on order. Do VertCat if you have to. WorldCat. I'm not going to explain to you all the layers of interlibrary loan, but just know that you can actually potentially get books from any library in the country sent to you. You just have to go through extra steps. Ask your local reference librarian about it. They will be so excited. All right, here we go. I blank do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of the President of the United States. I'm going to swear on my Microzine. Here we go. I, KeyGlyph, do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of the President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. Type in your first and last name and then press return. Key, you know what? I actually don't know if I have to do this in all capitals, so we'll do KeyGlyph, like this. Ooh. E.C. Meyer, stream yourself reading them. I would so do that. I've thought about doing book reading streams. I would love to do that. Here we go. Alright, I'll read it again. And I will swear once more over. I, KeyGlyph, do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of the President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. Your name is KeyGlyph, is this right? Yes! And I hope, I mean, this is actually kind of going to be a reading stream, folks. So settle in. We're going to be just reading a lot. And I'm going to do actually, since you all were really kind of on the voting in the beginning, as we come to our decision points, what I'll do is the first decision point that gets three votes, two or three, we will go with. So I'll let you all pick as we go through. I know all the answers. There are right ways to do things, so I don't want to lead this. I don't want to just blow through it and, you know, get a perfect score or whatever. So I'll let you all choose. Simon says, I was thinking about how to describe computer code to a Luddite that wanted to learn. A CYOA book was the closest analogy I could come up with. Pages of instructions read and executed in non-linear order. I hope they're going to dive into it. It's quite fun. It's hard to think that way in the beginning, but as you get better at it, it kind of comes to you quicker. And there is nothing like the satisfaction of solving a computer programming issue or coding or scripting after you've been working, you've been staring at it for like 2 hours and you're like, why isn't this working? And then suddenly, pfft, you get it. At least I have those eureka moments, and I live for eureka moments. E.C. Meyer said, I saw a stream of someone reading my new book live. That was interesting. Oh, that's so cool. I know that there's a librarian somewhere in the country who reads regularly over Twitch because she believes that no child should have to go to bed without having a story read to them. So if their parents can't do it or won't do it, they can tune into her Twitch stream and listen to a book. And I think that is the best. That makes my heart grow five sizes. Okay, today is October 27th, 2088. I would call it 2088 as a kid. 2088. I was really sad to realize that recently that I'm probably not going to live to 2088. I've got to try really hard. I'll be almost 103 in 2088. I'll be 102. Goals. I'm deciding it now. 20xdx, yep. Hey, Brigand. Welcome, welcome. Today is October 27th, 2088. You are the youngest president in the history of the United States. That was so much fun when you were actually, you know, eight, thinking about being an eight-year-old president. Gunstar Green, I probably won't be the youngest president then. Oh, I'm not aiming for the presidency. I just want to be able to wake up one day and just think to myself, I made it. I'm alive in 2088. That would just be really cool. Okay. You are gazing. Oh, look at that. You got the red, white, and blue stripes. You are gazing out the window of the Oval Office. A robot gardener rakes leaves into piles on the White House lawn. A dolphin wearing glider wings swoops across the grass, scattering the leaves. 2088 is awesome, y'all. Oh, that's what I'll do, E.C. Myers. I'll have to leave the Apple II in a will and will it to someone who will play this game in 2088. You turn and stare at the presidential optical laser discs scattered across your desk. One disc is called The Important Events of the 21st Century. You wonder what it was like years ago when only adults were elected president. Wavy lines as we think about that. Simon just finished watching Neon Genesis Evangelion. It takes place in the future year of 2016. I forgot about that. I watched through Evangelion, I guess 10 years ago now, and I really didn't retain a whole lot of it. Would you like to boot up The Important Events of the 21st Century? I'm going to just go ahead and make that decision for you all, because we should know. Hey, Capsule J, welcome! You're pretty sure Akira takes place in 2019. I kind of wish I could watch that, but I just know that I can't. It's too violent. Oh yes, here we go! I don't know if I've played this since 2001, so let's see what events we had in a parallel timeline to ours. The important events of the 21st century. New California, a colony on the moon, becomes America's 51st state in 2001. New California, oh my gosh. This is going to be so fun. This is going to be so fun. Simon says, I retained a lot. It still doesn't make much sense. I feel that I cannot comment on Evangelion because I don't want to step on anyone's love for it. I think it's got some great ideas in it, though. And I appreciate how it deconstructed the genre and was like, what would it really be like if we had people piloting these robots? How would that affect them mentally? Ooh, it's like we're tearing off the calendar page. In 2005, robots are granted the right to vote. That is the year after I graduated high school. I'm on board with that. Robot rights. All the way. E.C. Myers says, wow, WorldCat has some Microzine entries. Can you still request them? Let me tell you something about that, E.C. Myers. You can request anything through WorldCat. It's just whether or not the library is going to send it to you. Okay, real quick break to just explain how library lending works to all of you. If you sign up for a library card in your local library, they are usually part of a library network, which is going to be libraries in your area, but it's not going to be your whole state. So there's the network level, your immediate network, then there's the state level, all the libraries in your state, and then there's the whole country. So WorldCat is anywhere in the country. You can have a reference librarian. You can look at the WorldCat catalog, which is a catalog of all the things that all of the public libraries in this country have, who've been diligently entering their things into the system. You can request anything from any of those libraries. You often have to go through a reference librarian, though, because we have to fill out special paperwork and all this stuff. But as long as the lending library says, yes, we will send you a microzine, you can get it. But sometimes they won't. I requested Ultima 4 from a library through WorldCat when I first installed my Mockingboard sound card expansion in the Apple II because that game used it, and I wanted to test the sound card to make sure it worked, and the library declined to send it. I totally understand. A part of me felt like, who else is playing your copy of Ultima 4? But I totally get it. Sending that floppy disk out through, you know, national mail, I don't know. And I tried to request a music CD from Alaska. There was one library in the country that had it, and they wouldn't send it either. And again, I completely understand. But try! There's no reason to not try. You know what I mean? Gunstar Green is saying, I caught Akira on Sci-Fi Channel as a kid, and woo yeah, that was not meant for your eyes. I'm so sorry. Capsule J says, you would not recommend Akira for me. Yes. Oh, that's sad. I'm sorry that you were kind of borderline traumatized by it. Simon says, not enough Gundams in Akira. Folks, let me just take a moment out again to just say once more how much I love you all. This chat is just the best. You make me so happy. Okay, so, back to the important events of the 21st century. Robots were granted the right to vote in 2005. In 2010, Bradbury Territory, a colony on Mars, becomes America's 52nd state. And I also want to say right here that this game, since I played this game so early, for many, many years, it messed up my concept of how many states we had in America. I would have to think about it and be like, is it 50 or 52? Is it 50 or 52? Or I think I just thought it was 52 for a very long time. I didn't think that this was real. I obviously knew we didn't have a colony on Mars, but it just got kind of mixed up in my childhood synapses, and for at least until third grade, I would hesitate when talking about how many states we had because of this game. Simon, I cannot comment on Bender. I don't know Bender well enough. But I'm going to say, I don't know. I think it would depend on his crimes. Yeah, Bradbury Territory is very cute. And of course, as a kid, it goes right over your head. But now we get it. Now we get it. Ray Bradbury. All right, 2036. We are now past the current day. ESP music is invented. Humans use special helmets to listen to thoughtwave music. Oh, I wanted this to be a thing so badly. I'm obsessed with this idea, and I didn't actually realize it came from here. Obsessed. Obsessed. I'm giggling at Gunstar Green's very serious and kind of end of discussion. Yes. 2048. Scientists invent clicker phones, devices that allow dolphins to speak in human languages. In 2066, dolphins are granted the right to vote. Yeah! All the things that I care about are getting the right to vote. Brigand says, there is a game called Surviving Mars, where you start building a colony on Mars. You start with robots before you bring over colonists. It's neat. There were actually Isaac Asimov stories written about that very thing, and sometimes it didn't go particularly well. What system was that for, Brigand? Or computer? Capsule J says, did William Gibson write this game? You know, I don't know if that was a serious question or not, but I wonder if it actually annotates in the manual who worked on what game. I think it doesn't. I think it just lists the general cast. Yeah. It's a very small team, unless they're leaving a lot of people nameless, but small team. But again, I don't know how they got these games, really. I don't know if they assigned them to folks working for Scholastic and Microzine, or if they somehow got them from, you know, did they hire consultants, kind of, you know? That's true, Gunstar Green. Bradbury has a lot of Mars things not going very well, too, of course. You know, The Bradbury story that I always think about is There Will Come Soft Rains. That one I think about all the time. But that is Earth. But I think about that all the time. Okay, 2076. Knowledge nuggets are invented. After eating one, anyone over 5 years old instantly has a complete education on any specific subject. Whoa! I wonder how specific the subjects have to be. And who creates those nuggets? 2077. The minimum age to vote or hold public office is lowered to 5 years old, as one would imagine. Well, we all know how I feel about intelligent dolphins. 2084. You are elected president. Your vice president is Jenny Spoons, the famous time traveler. Oh yeah, Jenny. I forgot about her. You think about what you have accomplished during your first term. You've started the first colony on Venus and granted home computers the right to take vacations. Yes, all of the important things. Brigand says, is there an Apple II knowledge nugget? I wonder what they look like. What, you know, could you look at a knowledge nugget and know what knowledge you were going to get? Did they specifically make it look like what you were going to learn as kind of like a cutesy thing, you know? Were there better quality knowledge nuggets than others? We accomplished a lot during our first term. Now you are trying to win a second term in office, and the election is just 6 days away. You are running against Grimsby Snood, the teenage leader of the Anti-Computer Party. Boo! Grimsby Snood. Suddenly, your Jefferson 5000 computer nudges the office door open with his nose and leaps up to your desk. I love that sentence. Suddenly, your Jefferson 5000 computer nudges the office door open with his nose and leaps up to your desk. Simon says, are colors different subjects? Oh, I see. Capsule J is thinking about a random assortment of jelly beans. Yeah, what if you don't know what you're going to eat, and then you're like, no, I really didn't want to know all of that. That's so boring. When am I going to use this? It's like getting baseball cards. You know, some of them are going to be really great, and some of them are just going to be knowledge fodder. Is it dangerous to keep eating the same kind of knowledge nugget over and over? These are the important questions we ask on this stream. Look! It's Jeff! He's a little cat robot. Isn't he cute? Good morning, Chief! He purrs. Press return to continue or escape to quit. Gunstar Green says, well, that's Doctor Who is all heck. I don't know really anything about Doctor Who. I worked with, my boss in my previous job was a huge Doctor Who fan, and we had a Dalek in our office that actually worked. You could use a remote control to move it around, and it would say horrible things. And I asked her to explain Doctor Who to me at some point, and so I got, like, a breakdown, but not having seen it, it's sort of hard for me to know the aesthetic, you know? I have bad news, Jeff whirs. Vice President Spoons is exploring a time warp on Venus. You need to choose a temporary vice president for the election until she gets back. Bum bum bum, decision! Alright, folks. The first thing to get 3 votes is what we do. Jeff buzzes, do you want to? Oh, no, you know what? Sorry. You don't get to choose yet. We have to view the vice presidential data file. I'm not going to allow you all to skip past all that info. Sorry. Next decision point, I promise. Shh, Gunstar Green, be quiet. Maybe she hasn't gone in it yet. Maybe she hasn't decided whether or not it's safe. So here are our vice presidential prospects. Alice Somersault, Emily Ocean, or Norton 99. I say Emily Ocean because I just, like, flipped my lid when I saw that the dolphin was named Emily. This was back when... Actually, when was this published? When I was born, this is 1986, So this was made the year after I was born. When I was born, Emily was just starting to take hold as a popular name, but there weren't a lot of folks my age with that name yet, and it wasn't showing up in media like it shows up all the time now. So this was, like, super exciting that there was something named Emily. You know what I mean? Okay. Capsule J says, I think this is an easy choice. Well, hey, you don't know. These are the candidates for vice president. You need to learn about all of them first. Alice is so cool. Look at her orange hair. Okay. Norton 99. Robot. Built in Asbury Park, NJ, 2001. Status, governor of New Jersey. Yes. Profile. He was the drummer for the group Asteroid Noise before being elected governor. He could help you win the robot vote. If you folks don't know, I got excited because I grew up in New Jersey. So, and I forgot he was the governor of New Jersey. What a blessed time to live in New Jersey under a robot president. And that was the year that robots got the right to vote, I believe. No, 2005 was the year robots got the right to vote. Right? We all learned that in school, right? Think back to your textbooks. Gunstar Green, maybe by now that's true. It probably is a robot population, because you'll see, there are tensions. He could help you win the robot vote. All of these choices will matter, by the way. These different presidential, vice presidential selections will affect kind of how well you go over with their particular people. Alice Somersault, human, born on Mars 2075, mayor of Bradbury City, Mars. This teenager has never been to Earth, but is interested in American history in the 1980s. She could help win the Martian settler vote. Settler. Name, Emily Ocean. Data, dolphin. Born in the underwater city of Froggertown, Florida, 2076. Status, U.S. ambassador to the United Nations. Profile, she was the captain of the 2084 U.S. Olympic volleyball team. She could help win the dolphin vote. Decision point. After much consideration, you say, I want my vice president to be... All right, fill me up with the choices while I fill up with some water because my throat is dry. I'll be right back. I have to take a few steps over there to the kitchen. Get some water. Step over my cat cable, if you can see that. I hope you could see that. Excuse me. I hope you could see that ridiculous maneuver I had to do to get over my cat cable that's stretched across the entire apartment. Capsule J says 3333333333. Brigand 3. Simon says that's 12 votes for Emily, though they all came from one person. Norton 99. Okay. There's 2 votes for Emily Ocean and 1 vote for Norton 99. We need another vote to come in. Gunstar Green is not planning a robot uprising or anything. Well, we need 1 vote to come in for Emily to get Emily. But I shouldn't just assume. It occurs to me that we might not get enough votes depending on how all of you go. Alice, because Mars. Okay. 1 vote for Alice, 1 vote for Norton 99, and 2 for Emily Ocean. I don't even know how many of you are out there right now. Let me just take a quick look at my chat. Oh, we've got a good group, I think. Cool. Hello, lurkers. EC voted Emily. Oh, did I miss it? There we go. Okay. So we are going to do Emily Ocean. Thanks. Thanks for playing, you all. Capsule J says, come on, lurkers, time to exercise your rights. No, I love that people lurk. I think that's super cool. Just sit back and relax. No need to participate. Just let the Apple II vibes wash over you. You will be an unbeatable team against Grimsby Snood, Jeff purrs. Don't mention that wishy-washy kid's name, you moan. All Snood does is change his opinion to match the latest popularity poll, and his running mate Benedict Hunch is just as bad. I had my parents explain to me what wishy-washy was. I didn't understand it. Don't mention that wishy-washy kid's name. Simon says, it seems there are a lot of folks here who aren't voting. If I was watching on my phone, I wouldn't want to bother typing. your little crying face. No, and I, you know, putting people on the spot for voting, I'm only asking you all because you sort of rose to that occasion in the beginning of the stream. I often, if I'm in a stream and people are asking for votes, I just kind of like lock up and think, oh no, I don't know, that's a big decision. And so I don't say anything. So I totally sympathize with anybody who's like, no, I can't. Hey, Supercrackers. We're playing 2088 in Oval Office Odyssey from Microzine number 15. It is a twist-a-plot adventure. How are you doing? Welcome in. Capsule J says, I have also been wondering, but was afraid to ask. Don't ever be afraid, Capsule J. Don't ever be afraid. Oh, yes, okay. I was distracted by the name Benedict Hunch being kind of similar to Benedict Cumberbatch, just with a ch and Benedict. That's close enough for it to give you a slight bit of pause. Speaking of polls, you add, I'd like to see the latest presidential popularity poll. Right away, Chief. Jeff buzzes as the figures appear on his screen. This is cool how they do this. They make you wait for the results. They, like, come in real time. Presidential popularity poll. Percentage of voters who will vote for KeyGlyph and Grimsby Snood. Exactly, Supercrackers. It's a choose-your-own-adventure. That's what the Microzine issues, these digital magazines, called their choose-your-own-adventures. But also, E.C. Myers just dropped some knowledge in the chat earlier that Twist-a-Plot was actually also the name for printed books by Scholastic that were choose-your-own-adventures, and I did not know that. That is fascinating. And we were all discussing, you know, getting some from our local library. We are tied, folks. Should have gone for the robot vote. I know. Jeff is just like, really? You went with the dolphin? We're running neck and neck in the polls, you sigh. I'm sure you'll start beating Snood once your new VP starts campaigning, Jeff beeps. I like the way you think, Gunstar Green. Robots are able to vote at birth, so you can just build new voters. I'm sure there are regulations for that kind of thing. Although there aren't regulations on building human children, so. Later, you find Emily the Dolphin gliding around your office, bouncing a volleyball against a portrait of George Washington. This election is going to be a blast, she clicks. You notice George is scowling more than usual. Capsule J asking the tough questions. Capsule J is a member of Congress in 2088. Having debates on, trying to think of like a futuristic name for C-SPAN. October 28th, 2088. 10/28/2088. The next morning, you meet your VP outside and spin hulacopters around your hips. Hulacopters are hula hoops that collect magnetic energy from your body. By raising the hoop above your head, you can easily fly to your destination. I can't even tell you all how much these ideas got embedded in my brain as a kid. I actually thought about how that would work. You know, and actually it makes more sense as an adult in some senses because now I understand that the Earth has a magnetic field. And that we've learned recently, by the way, that spiders use the magnetic field of the Earth to float, not air. Did we read this article? It's fascinating. When spiders do that thing where they, like, stick up their abdomens and they have a string of web come out, we used to think that the web caught the breeze and they floated on the breeze, but actually they're, like, controlling static electricity or something to float with magnetic fields. And that's how they can float over huge bodies of water and such forth. Cyberspan 2088. Thank you, Simon. You nailed it. Stuck Green also nailed it. Oh, Simon wants me to share that article. I will get that prepared and either bring that next time or I will put it on my Twitter because I don't have it on hand. Capsule J says you'd probably be better at flying an actual helicopter than flying a hula hoop. Capsule J is in Congress and is part of the anti-computer league that Grimsby Snood is a part of. The Luddites. I'm kidding. I'm teasing you, Capsule J. You fly past the Washington Monument, waving at the cheering tourists. Jeff whirs, "Today, Chief, you must give a speech at the Robot Day picnic at Mount Robotmore, North Dakota." Isn't this game the greatest? You fly over the Appalachian Mountains and then head west until you reach North Dakota. The whole trip takes 10 minutes. A mountain with four faces carved on it appears in the distance. I guess what I'm thinking about now is how am I surviving the temperatures at high altitudes? That's what I'm wondering. You get frozen to your hula hoop. Simon says, "I knew about the silk casting. I just thought it was really like a thin kite. That's what everyone thought until just recently. There was a study done on spiders. A bunch of scientists tested it. I think they basically raised static electricity around spiders and saw them go into that ballooning motion, so they were being set off by electricity and magnetic stuff instead of by air. I'll have to review it to give you the real science information, but I think, you know what, Simon? I mean, I'm saying magnetic field. I'm pretty sure that that's it. I'm going to have to look at the article. It's either magnetic fields or static electricity or something like that. Hey, Hungary, welcome, welcome. Check out Mount Robotmore. This is what we have to look forward to if we can live to 2088. How are you doing tonight? Oh, you remember Capsule J? So I do have it right. I was freaking out a little bit under the questions, like, oh no, do I have it right? Because if I don't have it right... Oh, speaking of spiders, this is not a real spider, but I will show you my friend here. This is a creepy crawler that I made in my childhood. And for whatever reason, this creepy crawler has always lived on my Apple II as an adult. Every time I set it up in my apartments as an adult, I let this little creepy crawler live on my computer. He just likes it there, and he kind of fits the aesthetic, so he's always with me. I'm doing good, Hungry. Thank you for asking. Hoi, lovely folks, she says. I love spiders. I have an understanding with spiders. I will freak out if they move, like, very quickly around me, because I don't want them to get on me, because I might accidentally squash them. And I hate having to put them under glass because I'm afraid I'm going to miss. I did kill one once because it moved so quickly and I caught it with the edge of the glass and I felt terrible. So I stress out about that. You know, and if they're in a room, I might kind of be like, hello, spider, I'm going to be aware of you and kind of keeping track of you this entire time. But I think they're great in general. Simon says, wait a sec, isn't that third face one of the blockheads from Gumby? I don't know anything about Gumby. Maybe these are actual robot references that I don't know? Hungry Goria has a small crash test dummy that has moved with you and sits on your desk. He's looking at you right now. Well, hello, crash test dummy. Meet my spider friend. Hungry says, we've hired our bathroom spider to be a permanent resident. He's catching delicious meals all the time. That's awesome. That's excellent. As long as he doesn't venture into the shower and possibly get, like, hit by the water, you're all good. Okay, so Mount Robotmore. They are America's most honored robots. Norton 12, Norton 43, Norton 55, and Norton 65. Below you, thousands of picnicking robots sit on blankets while a few throw frisbees back and forth. As you land, you hear an electric guitar play Hail to the Chief. Jeff buzzes in your ear. Oh no, Robot Rock! This could be a disaster! Jeff asks, Chief, would you like to know more about Robot Rock? Yes, I would. Let me get to look at his cute face again. I never imagined him blue. Subject, Robot Rock. Data, robots don't listen to ESP music as humans do. Robots have electronic ears and love rock and roll played so loudly that buildings shake and collapse. Congress wants to ban Robot Rock. Capsule J wants to ban Robot Rock. Hey, Red! Thanks for the raid! Hello, everyone coming in from Red Stream. How was it? How were things? What did you do? Tell me the stuff. Hey, Coca-Cola! What up? You tell me how you're doing, too. For anyone that's new who hasn't seen this before, this is Apple IIsday. Welcome. We play games on my actual Apple IIe from childhood. And right now, we are playing the 15th issue of Microzine. This was a Scholastic-made digital periodical, essentially. Every couple of months, you would have mailed to you one of these editions, which would have a disc or two in it with educational games and cool stuff to do. And I was not a subscriber, sadly, but these came with my Apple II, which was a secondhand Apple II. So that's what we're doing. This is a twist-a-plot adventure, which was Scholastic's term for choose-your-own-adventure books and digital media. We now know it existed in print form, too, which is pretty cool. Coca-Cola, nice. He ain't got nobody. Capsule J, also these dang new model robots should turn down their music and get off my lawn. Yep. What we've been doing also, for all of you who just came in, we get decision points as the story goes on, and the first option in each decision point that gets three votes, we go with. So I'm letting you all choose where this story goes. No pressure, though. You don't have to vote if you don't want to. And by voting, I just mean type the number in the chat. I don't have anything fancy set up. All right, so our story continues. Oh, by the way, I am the President of the United States in this game. I'm the youngest President of the United States. I've already served a first term and done such things as established vacation days for personal computers, which is awesome. And we are 6 days away from re-election. And I have just anointed a kind of temporary vice president while my current VP is exploring a time vortex on Venus. And Emily is in fact my VP. She's a dolphin. This all makes sense, right? 2088 rules! Okay. As the robot band Metal Heavies plays, Emily spreads her glider wings and darts among the dancing robots, stealing their frisbees. I'd better tell the vice president to stop being so rowdy, you remark to Jeff. Emily's being a little party pooper. The band sounds like 1,000 lawnmowers roaring at once. Above you, Mount Robot Moor starts to shake, and cracks form across the giant robot faces while the robots dance blissfully. Decision! Get ready to vote. As pebbles rain from the mountain, you think, I'll just let the band play for just one more song, or I'm going to have to pull the band's plug. What are we going to do? Are we going to let them play for one more song and hope that all goes well? Or are we going to pull the plug and possibly hurt our chances with the robot vote? Hungry votes one. That's one vote for one. Pull the plug, says Capsule J. Let them play, says Simon. One more song, says Supercrackers. All right. Yeah, we're going to let the robot rock continue. Capsule J, I really like that you're taking this fictional identity on. It's so funny. Wow, a lot of you are on the robot rock side. All right, I'll just let the band play for one more song. Or it's, I'll let the band play for just one more song. I keep wanting to put in the just. I'll let the band play for just one more song. Suddenly, the faces of Mount Robotmoor crumble into an avalanche of boulders and billowing dust. When the rock slide stops, you help injured robots into a flying hospital, which hovers above the disaster. Oh, sure, Red. Have good family time. I wonder if Daft Punk is around. Congratulations, Daft Punk, on your right to vote. Your hard-earned right to vote. You returned to the White House to see how the Telecycle TV news covered your decision. You climb on your telecycle, which looks like a bicycle, but is really a three-dimensional television. By pedaling, you are suddenly surrounded by three-dimensional TV images. Brigand says Daft Punk is considered classical in 2088. Capsule J says, I'm so disappointed in all of y'all. You ride through a soap opera and swerve to avoid a used computer commercial. You glide into the news. A news bot is interviewing an Earth person, a dolphin, a robot, and a Martian settler. This is so cool to me. You get, like, the feel from all the different groups on these screens. This will happen after every major decision. It's great. The newsbot asks, what do you think about the president's decision? The human says, what a big mistake! The dolphin says, it was a big disaster! Look at our futuristic human space clothes that we get. You know, I never really thought about it. It must be... Oh yeah, so it's probably Martian settler, and then Earth person is the other human being there. That's why the two humans have such different styles. The human says, the president was wrong, and the robot says, no, it was our fault. Aww. Capsule J, are dolphins not Earth persons? I'm sure that they are considered so, but they're their own kind of... seems prejudiced. I'm gonna assume that the... Hey, Keldar! When did you get here? Well, I mean, it's true. I mean, I don't really have a whole lot of high hopes for humans to shed their bigotry by 2088, sadly. They should be Earth persons. I'm going to choose to believe in my mind that the dolphins are a group that wants to have their own opinion out there. They are so culturally different that they need to represent their own views, because the Earth person is the person interviewing these folks, and we don't see who they are. So, I'm not really sure. You see how hard I am? I'm trying to make this okay. Oh, Simon, thank you. I think Earth is in reference to the ground and dirt. Dolphins are water persons. And, well, then you've got the robot issue, you know? But I guess not all robots would be Earth persons, because they don't necessarily all live on Earth. But that is a good explanation, Simon, and I like it. I'm not trying to, like, there are going to be problems with this stuff, but that was a funny discussion. But did you see how I kind of wanted to make it okay? Gunstar Green says, the dolphins move to have the planet's name changed to Ocean, as it rightfully should be, right? Oh my gosh, you guys. I just want you all to write tons of fanfiction about this game. I just want it. I want it so bad. This is what Snood and Hunch have to say. Vote for me. I'll ban Robot Rock. I agree. You can't see Capsule J, but he's there on the green. Keldar, that's an offensive term for robots. Please do not use that in my chat. I do not tolerate bigotry of any kind. Snood does not look like a teenager, Gunstar Green. Simon wants to know the human population amount compared to dolphins, though. I mean, interesting. I don't know. I don't even know what it is now, actually. I'm going to assume that in 2088, when we've created a device that allows us to understand dolphin speech, that suddenly we're going to care about their rights. And they're going to thrive, instead of being caught in fishing nets and confused by underwater military blasts and captured to be put in bars in different places in the world and killed for their teeth, etc., etc., etc. I read a whole book about all this stuff. I read a book that was basically just examining the cruelty that we have exhibited towards and on dolphins for a very long time. It was a very difficult read. The news bot continues, here's the standing in the polls. Let's see, how did this affect our voting percentage? Oh no! We're slipping in the polls! Simon says, I wouldn't ban robot rock, but at most, some ordinances restricting decibel levels or certain miles outside of city limits. That's very nuanced. Simon is also in Congress in 2088. You're a centrist. Capsule J says, U.S. government drastically raises census budget to give all workers scuba lessons. Keldar says, so this is a game based on politics? From my understanding, that means it's unwinnable, heh? I'll have you know that it's extremely winnable. But, yes, the concept of this is that you're the youngest president in the year 2088. And you have to kind of solve the problems of the citizens. October 29th, 2088. The next morning, you catch Jeff staring at a mouse hole. Looking for breakfast, you joke? Wow. I'm glad Jeff took that in stride. Jeff stammers, no, Chief. I'm just anxious to get going to our underwater press conference in Froggertown. Gunstar Green says, I am a robot, you moron. I know, that's why I feel like that was slightly offensive, and Jeff could have taken that poorly. You know? I hope I make a good speech, you say. There are a lot of votes in Froggertown. You board the presidential submarine. Yes, there's a presidential submarine, which is shaped like a huge seahorse. Yes, it's shaped like a huge seahorse! And sail down the coast towards Florida. Get me to 2088. Emily, your dolphin VP, swims alongside, occasionally darting to the surface for air. You reach the underwater city of Froggertown. Citizens swim down to the streets wearing skin diving suits. A group of dolphins waits at an underwater traffic light. We're gonna get a picture right now. I cannot wait to see this in color. I cannot wait. Oh my gosh, it's beautiful. Oh. The different amber patterns just do not do that justice. Wow. I wanted to live here as a child. Surprise. No, Simon, we put both of those guys in jail. They're in jail right now. Look at how beautiful that is, though. Dang. Gotta cross-stitch that. There are traffic lights underwater. Apparently we're only concerned with certain planes of movement. I mean, we're only seeing that signal, but I'm assuming there are specific designated currents that you swim in, and verticals and horizontals are represented. Who even knows? What's that thing in the background underneath the traffic light? That looks like it might be a jellyfish, yeah? That is almost impossible to see on the amber screen or to know what it is. But in color, that definitely looks like a jellyfish, yeah? That's so cool. That's so cool. I can't get over it. For all the fish school buses, but shh. That's good. Simon, are you keeping track of all of the other media that ripped off this Microzine game? Yep. Jeff beeps, the reporters are going to ask what you think about the Send the Fish to School movement. Do you want to know more about this subject? Yes, I do. Subject, Send the Fish to School. Data. Dolphins can't digest knowledge nuggets like humans can, so they must be educated in schools. But dolphins would rather play than go to school. A group called Send the Fish to School wants to force dolphins to attend school. Yeah, Simon. For sure. That actually comes up in something. There are groups that have names that are kind of, like, offensive on purpose like that. And they're clearly showing you what this group feels about dolphins, and that there are no dolphins in that group called Send the Fish to School. I'm a really great president, Keldar. I need to know about world issues and how people feel to make my decisions. How should I solve this problem, you ask Jeff. Jeff beeps, use your heart and mind to decide. Remember, Chief, that you can't please everybody. The right decision isn't always the most popular one. You dock the submarine and are mobbed by a horde of reporters all shouting, what is your position on the Send the Fish to School issue? It's gonna be voting time, folks. Just sections, Keldar. This is an underwater city for dolphins, basically. Or a major metropolis, a major dolphin metropolis. But we've got people living on Earth, and we also have colonies on Mars and the Moon, and we're going to, and I just established one on Venus during my first, oh my gosh, I cannot, term. I could not get, thank you, Daniel, my husband throws out term. I could not get the word semester out of my head. I kept thinking first semester, and I was just like, I can't get out of that loop. Please tell them dolphins are mammals, not fish, Emily clicks in your ear. See? And do you realize the only class taught in dolphin school is how to spell long words that have something to do with mathematics? Why can't they teach useful subjects like computer science or volleyball? See, now we're getting the nuanced view from our VP, right? The only class taught in dolphin school is how to spell long words that have something to do with mathematics. Why can't they teach useful subjects? Emily asks, do you want to tell the reporters about my idea? Yes or no, folks. It's up to you. Do you want me to send my temporary VP in to talk with these hounding reporters? Yes, says Simon. Listen to the dolphin, says Gunstar Green. Where's my PR department? Yes, says Capsule J. Or, why, says Capsule J. So let's do it. Where's my PR department? After you tell the press about Emily's idea, you are surrounded by dolphins who cheer, we're going to vote for you! Making the changes in the world that we want to see, my friends. Simon says, I agree with the sentiment, but not with its execution, and must, reluctantly, not support this bill as it is written. That's funny. The dolphin vote is secured. We'll see. You return to the White House to see how the Telecycle TV news covered your decision. Oh, but bum, Keldar. The newsbot asks, what do you think about the president's decision? The Martian colonist says, the president has style. The dolphin says, the president is fair. The Earth person says, the VP is far out, too. Far out, man. That's how you know we're from Earth. The robot says, I'll vote for them. Yes. Yes. I'm so proud of you all. You all have a future in politics. This is what Snood and Hunch have to say. The president's decisions never work. Ha! I agree. Gunstar Green says those four people are the only voters whose opinions matter. Yeah, they're the four talking heads that keep appearing on that Monday morning TV show. I don't know why I said Monday morning, I just meant like early morning TV show. But I guess it's airing on Mondays in 2088. Because it just popped into my head that way. The newsbot continues, here's the standing in the polls. This may wind up not being so much of a variety night, everybody, since this game is long. Yay! We pulled ahead! So, forgive me if we don't actually do a whole lot of variety. We do have a surprise at the end, again, I'll remind you, that we'll be doing. We will be doing that no matter what. So even if this finishes at 8 o'clock my time on the dot, we will still be doing the surprise afterwards. But Let's see how far we can get through this. 53% of the vote. It's true, Gunstar Green, that tie. Keldar says, I should run on the platform of legalizing seaweed. That's funny. October 30th, 2088. The next day, you and your staff board a donut-shaped flying saucer and take off for Mars. Yes! The World Series starts today in Bradbury City. Yes! And you are going to throw out the first ball. Yes! 2088! As you orbit Mars, you say, I've heard that some Martian settlers want to split off from the U.S. just like the Confederacy did during the Civil War. Jeff beeps, would you like to know more about the situation on Mars? Yes, we do. This sounds like a sticky one. Simon says, before I forget, if anyone likes this game, it reminds me way too much of a more modern game called Fate of the World. You're elected world leader with sweeping powers, and it's really an extension of everything we've seen so far. Really interesting. That's like a Steam game? PlayStation? PSN kind of thing? Give me some details. Gunstar Green says, messing up the first pitch will end your whole career. Wouldn't it be great if it suddenly cut to, like, an actual mechanic where I had to throw? Subject: Conflict on Mars. Data. Martian settlers long for a simpler way of life. They want to break off all contact with 2088 America and return to the peaceful days of the 1980s. Okay. That's interesting, though. I imagine this is a group that's like, no more cell phones, no more, you know, computers advanced beyond the Apple II. Cars that pollute. Red says, I have to share a brief story because. Please do. The donut-shaped saucer enters the Martian atmosphere, known as a dunk maneuver, and zips toward the huge dome that covers Bradbury City. Here we go! Oh, man. I cannot get over these graphics in color. Oh. I should print them all out and just put them up on my walls. Just frame them all. Oh, my gosh. Oh. They were cool in amber, but I'm in love with these graphics. In love with them. Red Sun Luke thinks that Alex Trebek and What's-His-Face are the same person. What's his name? I can't remember. Capsule J says, is this your first time playing this game on a color monitor? I am actually not playing it on a color monitor. I'm playing it on my Apple II with my amber monitor, but since I'm capturing the out, so I'm basically splitting between the monitor in front of me and my capture card, and when it goes through my capture card, it just gets interpreted as, you know, a regular TV would interpret the signal. So when I'm doing this, I'm actually looking at my laptop's, I'm looking at my OBS, and looking at the capture of the output, which is showing me the graphics in color. Pat Sajak, thank you. Your ship is met by a crowd of Martian settlers, all lugging tape recorders playing an old song called Thriller. Emily clicks, I know how to get their vote, and dances to the music. As the Martians applaud, you chuckle, I never thought I'd see a dolphin do the moonwalk on Mars. Whoa. 2088, truly a blessed time. Seeing a dolphin do the moonwalk on Mars. You travel to Spielberg Stadium in an antique vehicle called an automobile. You see the Martian team, the Granolas, slouched in the dugout grumbling, while the Baltimore Bites set up their baseball radars in the outfield. The Granolas. That's funny now. That's funny as an adult. The Granolas captain stalks up and sputters, we've had it! All season we've played against teams that use computerized homer hitting bats and those radar mitts that always catch pop flies. Either the Bites play baseball the old-fashioned way, or we quit! When the Bites hear this, they stomp off the field, too. This is terrible, you moan, pacing back and forth. This incident could ruin my chances for re-election. I really wish my first thought wasn't always, this could ruin my chances at re-election. But I suppose we are trying to roleplay a politician here. All right, you ready? What do you want to do, Jeff Beeps? Force the two teams to play baseball or postpone the World Series and work out a compromise? Let's get those votes in. Let's get those votes in. Yeah, these granolas want to go back to the 1980s Earth days. This is a tough one. World's Series? You're right, Capsule J. You're right. 2-1. We got one vote for each. Bum 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 ba dum bum. This is a toughie. 1, Capsule J. Force the two teams to play baseball. We're one away from forcing them to play baseball. 2 away from postponing the World Series. The World's Series. Lay down the iron fist and force them to play, says Supercrackers. Okay. Play some ball. 2 so someone will be forced to break the tie. I did count that right, though, right? 1-1-1, yeah. That's nice, though, Gunstar Green. I like it. I like it. A strange use of executive power here, indeed. Here we go. By executive order, you yell, play ball! The two teams refuse to go onto the field. The governor of Mars walks up and says, you Earth Americans will never understand us Martian settlers. We are seceding from the U.S. Oh, crud! That's right, we forgot that there were, or perhaps we didn't realize the gravity of the comparison to the Civil War. You return to the White House to see how the Telecycle TV news covered your decision. You Earth Americans! You folks can battle it out in the chat. The newsbot asks, what do you think about the president's decision? The Martian says, we should compromise. The dolphin says, the president was wrong. The Earth person says, don't vote for the president. The robot says, we don't want a civil war. Oh, this is bad. This is bad. Thank you, Red. I will check it out. Well, I guess the Martian vote no longer counts, says Simon. That's true. We'll just lop off that group of voters no longer voting because they have seceded immediately. This is what Snoot and Hunch have to say. Vote for me. I won't start a civil war. I agree. I always think that voice in my head, Hunch's voice, is I agree. Vote for me. I won't start a civil war. Yeah. Right, Gunstar? Drop a colony on him. The newsbot continues, here's the standing in the polls. Oh, snap. So we're kind of, every decision we're sliding a little bit, just a little bit. We're trading places. Alright, October 31st, 2088. Today is Halloween, and you dress like George Washington. Very inventive, President KeyGlyph. Little robots trick-or-treating as munchkins ring your doorbell all night. Little robots trick-or-treating as munchkins. Is there a joke there that I'm not getting? I mean, I'm assuming munchkins is Oompa Loompas? I feel like there's a joke in there I'm missing. The robots combined with munchkins. Let's just imagine that they're trick-or-treating as little tiny donut holes. But at midnight, you answer the door and an egg splats in your face. Another picture. Yo! They're purple! Oh my gosh, that's so cool! That's so cool! The sky is filled with mischievous dolphins wearing bat wings! Yes, yes! Oh, the munchkins were little people from The Wizard of Oz, yeah? Probably Brigand? I have not seen The Wizard of Oz, if you can believe it. Capsule J says they're both exploited worker classes. Yes. All little robots dress as munchkins for Halloween to send a message to the president. Aren't they magnificent? They are wonderful. The graphics in this game, I'm telling you. Gunstar Green says, the Mars Dolphins launch their first attack. You shake your fist and shut the door. You get on your telecycle and watch the news. Nemo Ahab, the mayor of Frogertown, appears saying, emergency, a group of children trick-or-treating by the Sargasso Sea is missing. You rush to your submarine, but Jeff bounces in, beeping, Chief, Emily is a hero. She found those lost Frogertown kids. Yeah, Emily Ocean. Alright, November 1st, 2088. As you play volleyball with Emily in the White House pool, you ask her how she found the lost children. I used my internal sonar, which is called echolocation, she says. I whistle and click and use the echoes to navigate underwater. I think this was my introduction to this idea, and I looked it up from this game. I was like, whoa. Dolphins could teach humans to develop sonar, Emily clicks. Teach me, you exclaim. Yeah. An hour later, you can swim and play volleyball blindfolded. You use sonar to bounce Emily the ball with your nose, shouting, I'm a full-fledged dolphin! Wow, an hour later. I'm a quick study. Quick study, yo. But this begs the question, why haven't we been teaching children sonar at this point? You know? These dolphins are citizens of our nation now. That afternoon, Grimsby Snood struts into the Oval Office, sneering, have you chickened out of our televised debate yet? And I say, I'm not a chicken, you're a turkey, cowabunga! No, that's not what I say. I say, I'm not afraid of a wishy-washy candidate like you, you say calmly. Oh, I'm not afraid of a wishy-washy candidate like you, I say calmly. You're all making me laugh in there. Suddenly, Jeff leaps into the room, beeping, Chief, something strange has landed on the lawn. Grimsby steps on Jeff's tail, snarling, Out of my way, mechanical mouser. You all rush out to the lawn and see a strange device that resembles a metallic spider. When was the first Turtles comic published? I mean, mouser is a word. So calling something a mechanical mouser is not far-fetched if it's going to be a robot cat, but isn't that funny? Just because that word became so strongly associated with that one particular kind of mechanical thing. Thanks for the turtle, Brigand. 1984, says Simon. Okay. So this was might have been a little bit of a reference to the Ninja Turtles, possibly. Another picture. Oh, snap! On the object is a screen with a button and strange alien writing. Look at that. Look how cool that is. I thought this was at night. Oh no, this is the next day, right? We got egged at night. That's why it's light outside. I always assumed that this was a nighttime scene. Jeff Wurz. Those symbols say, somehow he can read them, I am a space probe. If you are an intelligent life form, please push the button. You'll be the first president in history to make contact with an alien civilization, Jeff beeps. That will bring you a lot of votes. Again, right with the, that will bring you a lot of votes. Then Jeff frowns and buzzes. On the other hand, the let's pretend we're not at home people will want to destroy this probe. Jeff asks, do you want more information on the let's pretend we're not at home people? Yes. Gunstar Green says, time to accidentally start an alien war and a civil war at the same time. We're going full Contra hardcore right now. Subject, let's pretend we're not at home party. Data. In 2025, a space probe landed from In 2025, a space probe from another planet landed in inventor Andy Logo's backyard. Logo destroyed it because he was afraid Earth would be invaded by aliens. Smooth move, Logo. It's like if they've landed, they might already... Anyway. Logo started the Let's Pretend We're Not at Home party. They believe that we should destroy all alien space probes. Logo also invented an anti-science fiction ray that destroyed all sci-fi books, movies, and TV shows. Whoa! So did we lose? I think this is telling us, I don't remember this part, that all science fiction books, movies, and TV shows have been destroyed? Whoa. Capsule Dre says, hashtag Logo did nothing wrong. Yeah, E.C. Myers, that's painful. That is painful. And then Logo was murdered. What do you want to do about the probe? Jeff asks. Push the button and make contact, or destroy the probe? Let's go, folks. Right, Gunstar Green, that's what I mean. He was set upon by the citizens. Two, 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 says Capsule J. All right, one vote for destroying it. One vote for pushing the button and making contact. I like how Capsule J tries to sneak in extra votes. Gunstar Green wants to make contact. Aliens can't vote yet anyway. Always with the votes. Brigand wants us to push the button to make contact. That's three. We're going to push the button. Kitsarito also wants us to push the button. Yeah, feel even after we finish voting, feel free to vote. Because, hey, Musty Hobbit. Because it might be fun to see how you all fall, and then you can all battle it out. I believe these aliens are friendly, you say, and reach to push the button. Suddenly, Grimsby knocks you down and grabs the probe under his arm. That was a... I always think of this when I play this game, that the probe seemed really big in the picture, so I'm like imagining it's either way smaller than I thought, or Grimsby's got some shoulders. I belong to the Let's Pretend We're Not at Home party, he yells. I won't let you contact any crummy aliens. How are you doing, Musty Hobbit? We are playing a twist-a-plot. A Microzine twist-a-plot right now. I'm the youngest president of the United States. It is the year 2088, and we are up to all kinds of futuristic shenanigans. Grimsby, stop! You yell, and chase him all the way to the Lincoln Memorial. Whoa! I got legs. Where he flies away with the stolen probe on a helicopter. You look up at the statue of Abraham Lincoln and say, Oh, Abe, this might have been humanity's last chance to contact aliens. Having now been to the Lincoln Memorial, I understand how crowded that place is, so I'm... This scene always evoked this image of just me alone with the Lincoln Memorial, you know, as you see it in movies and stuff, but I'm trying to imagine what that would actually be like with that amount of people there, you know? Was I, like, pushing them out of the way, punching them, and trying to have this, like, sweet moment with the Lincoln Memorial with all these people nearby just being like, God, get out of the way! I want to have my moment with Abe. I want to have my picture. You return to the White House to see how the Telecycle TV news covered your decision. Exactly, Musty Hobbit. It's a choose-your-own-adventure. Exactly. The newsbot asks, What do you think about the president's decision? Snood mustn't destroy it, says the Martian settler. Our president is brave, says the dolphin. Aliens make me nervous, says the Earth person. The president is wise, says the robot. Oh, true, Capital J, I forget. They saw me making for it, and they all got on scooters and stuff to get there before me. This is what Snood and Hunch have to say. Aliens from space are dangerous. I agree. These are our challengers in the presidential race, who basically just choose the opposite of everything I choose, but also hate aliens and computers. The newsbot continues, Here's the standing in the polls. Hey, Enron! Welcome, welcome! How are you doing tonight? Doing another twist-a-plot adventure right now. Oh, we're tied again! We're tied again! At dusk, you meet Jeff in the Oval Office. Today, Congress outlawed robot rock, Jeff buzzes, and a group of dolphins play hooky from school, and Mars seceded from the Union. We're having a very bad day today. If you can solve these problems, you'll win tomorrow's election for sure. All right, let's get down to it. Let's solve these major problems overnight. Isn't that cool, Enron? It's really neat. You snap your fingers and shout, "Let's use the presidential time telephone to call the great presidents of the past for advice!" You connect the phone while Jeff pages through the time phone book, beeping. There are 4 presidents who have listed numbers. You know it, Capsule J. So in case you want to, like, a little bit of a peek behind the curtain as to how the game works, your VP matters because every VP will basically solve one of the situations for you and raise your votes with that group, and they will also teach you something that you need to know. So you really actually have to play the game through 3 times to know, to kind of metagame all of the answers. You'll see. You'll see how it turns out. But yeah, that's basically how this works. All right, dial the phone number of the president you want to speak with. Call Betsy! Betsy Franklin! I know, isn't that cool? When I played this game, I was like, what? You know? I was like, was that actually a president? All right, Betsy. 555-4466. Betsy knows what's up. The president answers the phone and says, hello. And then I have to give my spiel and be like, I'm not a telemarketer, I swear. I'm the president of the United States in the year 2088, you say. I'm like blurting it out. I'd like your advice about solving one of the problems facing our nation. Take me seriously, please, don't hang up. And they're like, another one of these calls. After you tell Betsy Franklin about the stolen space probe, she says, if you broadcast a science fiction movie about friendly aliens, the let's pretend we're not at home people might change their minds and return the space probe. Capsule J, you might be onto something there. Thank you for your advice, you say. You chat for a few more minutes and hang up. You might be onto something. We'll call them all. Jeff asks, do you want to talk to another president on the time telephone? Yes, I do. This is the lead up to the end game. How do we call George Washington? Time travel, I accept, but how do we get a phone back to him? We've prepared ahead of time. None of these presidents know the time telephone is there, but it's there. So suddenly something's gonna ring and they're gonna just be like, this seems like I do this with it? Okay. So I'm just gonna go ahead and call. We're gonna do, let's do Abraham Lincoln, because we were wondering if maybe Abe was gonna be able to help us with the Civil War situation. I'm all like, Abe, I was just at your memorial, you have one of those, you know, and I was trying to have this moment with you, and, you know. The president answers the phone and says, hello. I'm the president of the United States in the year 2088, you say. I'd like your advice about solving one of the problems facing our nation. I'm a very desperate president. After you tell Abraham Lincoln about the Martian settlers, he says, you must avoid a civil war with Mars. A house divided against itself cannot stand. Is there a way the Martians could time travel to the 1980s? That way they could be at home in both centuries. Wise. Wise. Thank you for your advice, you say. You chat for a few more minutes and hang up. We chat for a few more minutes and I say, hey, by the way, I've got something really important to tell you. And then the scene from Back to the Future ensues, where he's like, no, you can't tell me. And I'm like, please let me tell you. It's very important. Take this letter. Open it, please. Jeff asks, do you want to talk to another president on the time telephone? Yes, I do. Fake news, says Enron. All right, Jefferson, what do you got for me? The president answers the phone and says, hello, I'm the president of the United States in the year 2088, you say. I'd like your advice about solving one of the problems facing our nation. After you tell Thomas Jefferson about Robot Rock, he says, isn't there a device that robots could put over their ears so only they would hear their loud music? Remember, everyone has the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of rock and roll. Thank you for your advice, you say. You chat for a few more minutes and hang up. If you all want to write the fanfiction of how the telephones get there, that's another idea on the table. Maybe when we invented time travel, we went back to all of the presidents, or we installed a time telephone in the different Oval Offices, and we kind of had like a orientation meeting with every president to explain. What could go wrong? Jeff asks, do you want to talk to another president on the time telephone? Yes, I do. Yeah, Tom, yeah. All right, Teddy. The president answers the phone and says, hello, I know why you've called. And we say, oh my God! You knew! After you tell Teddy Roosevelt about dolphin school, he says, bully for the dolphins! Isn't there anything dolphins can teach humans? If dolphins are teachers as well as students, they'll be happier going to dolphin school. Hashtag representation matters. Thank you for your advice, you say. You chat for a few more minutes and hang up. Bully on the dolphins. Do I want to talk to another president? No. Well, no. You can just dial random numbers and it'll just be, I forget what it says. But you can type in numbers that aren't those and something happens. Let's see if I can use that advice to solve our problems, you say, scratching Jeff's ear. Right, Chief, Jeff purrs. The more problems you solve, the more votes you will get. I know, right, Enron? Right? Doesn't that just hurt all of us? Hurt all of us in our hearts? All right, here we go, folks. I know the answers, but I will take suggestions from all of you. We have to solve the major problems facing the nation in 2088, or we're not going to get reelected. And Grimsby Snood is going to take over and destroy the probe and all kinds of stuff. Jeff asks, what device could robots use to listen to music without disturbing humans? We reply. Kitsarita says, you're really good at reading out loud, by the way, Oh, well, thank you. Sometimes I'm not sure if I'm doing too much of a voice or not, but I do love to read. Human brain, Simon. Simon's not getting reelected to Congress. As soon as you said that, it got, like, sent all over these time devices and things, the telecycles and stuff, and everyone was like, wow, lasers? Come on, folks. Gunstar Green's not getting elected either. Enron says, yes, you were a good reader. You could make money reading bedtime stories. Well, we talked about that earlier, actually. There are streamers who stream reading books out loud. And I've thought about doing that, about like reading children's books out loud and stuff so kids could tune in. Simon said, the earlier clue said it's because of their brains why they can't listen to ESP music like the rest of humans do. A spaceship. Does anyone have a serious answer, or am I going to have to go with one of these? What device could robot... I know you're all just poking fun at me. I can put in one of these answers if you want me to go with the silly answers. Human brains. What device? Human brains. Oh my god, really? Says Enron. Really to what? Is it as simple as headphones? Headphones? I mean, that sounds like a pretty solid idea. I'm just saying. Dolphin brains? We're gonna go with headphones. I reply, headphones. How could Martians time travel to the 1980s? You reply. And, it sometimes matters how you enter things in, so I actually forget exactly how to enter this in. VP Emily Ocean has left the chat. Enron says, is that the number of characters? The answer has to be no. I believe that's just... I don't think so. The DeLorean? All right. Kitsurito, that is a good answer. We're going to put it in. Should I write the DeLorean? Phone booth? You're also funny. The DeLorean or just DeLorean? That's really funny that you both came up with the DeLorean. Is that, do you actually, does it have camel case like that? I'm going to put it in like that. I watched Bill and Ted once as an adult and I retained zero of it. What can dolphins teach human beings? You reply. Now this one we should know. This one we were actually given. Oh, camel case. Well, I guess it wasn't really camel case, but in programming, camel case is when you capitalize a letter of the second word. So if you write like info Emily, it would be lowercase info and then capital E Emily. It's just a tradition in some scripting and coding for some reason, and I like it actually. So it'd be like info Kitsurito, and the K would be capitalized. Love volleyball. How to balance balls on our noses. Camel case is like. I like Gunstar's love volleyball. They can. SpongeBob case. Did we learn about anything the dolphins could teach human beings directly in our story with our VP, Emily Ocean? Volleyball is a strong contender. But are there any other guesses? How to spell long words? No, that's the thing they hate in school. You're just insulting them now, Simon. Simon gets 0% of the dolphin vote. We can go with volleyball. What do we think, friends? Volleyball? Volleyball. We'll do volleyball. What's funny is, oh, I guess no. I thought... How to fly and aim eggs with accuracy, indeed. What science fiction movie wasn't destroyed by Andy Logo? Now, this is something that we would never know. But we were advised to broadcast a movie where aliens are friendly, so give me a movie that has friendly aliens in it. Because this is actually not a real movie. This is a movie... title that they made up, so if you don't play through the game with the Martian VP, you don't know the answer to this. Battlefield Earth? I've not seen Battlefield Earth, and I feel like that might not be a peaceful movie. E.T.? Doctor Who? Alright, let's do E.T., because we've got multiple E.T.s. Oops, I can't put in a... That's my computer barking at me for trying to put in a dot. All right. Jeff thinks a moment, then beeps. By my estimation, Chief, these are the questions you answered correctly. Headphones! Woo! This means you've solved one of the nation's four major problems. Good job, folks. Independence Day! Enron, get out of here. What are you talking about? Beep, beep, beep. So we got one right. At 10 p.m., you return to Washington, D.C. to make your final speech of the campaign. You sit behind your desk and look into the 3D TV cameras. You say, my fellow Americans, let me do it like this. I need to be like leaning on a desk. My fellow Americans, I wish my prompter were more in front of me. My fellow Americans, I firmly believe that I can continue to solve this nation's problems. If robots will listen to rock and roll with headphones, there will be no robot rock crisis. You smile into the camera and say, please vote for me tomorrow. November 2nd, 2088. Election day is finally here. After you cast your ballot at a voting saucer, you ride your telecycle to see the election results. You pedal up to the election screen and wait to see the votes come in from all over the United States. Check this out. It's gonna be a nail biter. Look at this. So we've got all of our colonies represented. Mars, Earth, the Moon. President KeyGlyph wins with 57% of the vote. I didn't know that you could win with just that answer. I thought that the answers at the end were what mattered, you know, if you got them right or not, but only getting one of them right and winning makes me wonder, because we did make some really good decisions along the way. Yeah, Enron, I was thinking that too, but I lost to the Electoral College. Chief, we've won! Jeff beeps, doing cartwheels across the floor. You look up and see the portrait of George Washington is beaming. You go to sleep that night proud of your accomplishments, but you wish you could have saved the space probe and been the first president to make contact with an alien civilization. ... The end. So I like that they put that little unfinished business at the end there, so you think, oh, I should play this again and get more right. Like, I won, but I didn't get the best ending. And I like that they put that in your mind. So, hey, I hope you folks all enjoyed this game. I loved this game as a child. It ignited my love for Choose Your Own Adventures. It was pivotal in my desire to want to learn how to read. And the other twist of plots were too, but this one in particular, I just loved to pieces. I loved this to pieces. So, it was nice to share it all with all of you. And good job making decisions as my council and my Congress. Capital J says, that was really interesting. Maybe I'll play through it again on another stream so that we can see, you know, the other VPs and stuff. But that was a long time going. So here's the thing. I have a surprise for us to do at the end of the stream. I feel a little bit sad that we didn't do another game on this disc, but we'll just come back to this Microzine on another day, I think, and we'll do, because that's the beefy game on the disc. That's like the main event on that disc. So we can come back and do the keyboarding game and the roundup game and things, because those are all sort of like quick things to pick off. So maybe we'll even do that next week, but we'll see. Brigand says, you should highlight this 2-hour stream since I doubt anyone else on Twitch has streamed it. Can I do highlights? I'm not an affiliate, so I'm not really sure how that works. To be honest, I have passed the qualifications for an affiliate, but I have not affiliated, and for a time I had the benefits of being an affiliate without having to affiliate, but they've changed that now. So until I actually give them a tax ID, I can't upload videos to Twitch and things like that, so I don't know if highlights are part of that. But Capsule J says, I was considering streaming a visual novel later this year, but had doubts. Based on the stream, I think it could work. Capsule J, you'll be amazed at how many people are into what you're into, is what I've discovered from streaming. That people will hang around and enjoy this kind of thing. I never thought that streaming a text adventure would be something that folks would dig, but here you all are making it the best time. Simon says, I think I'm supposed to remind you about poetry in other languages. Simon, remind me about that on Thursday night. We gotta talk about that. Oh, Brigand and Kitsarito telling me that I can highlight. All right, well, maybe I'll look into doing that, but I don't know if I can after I've stopped streaming, because I don't auto-archive my streams, because on Thursday nights I do the after party, which is supposed to be like a very homey space for everyone, and I don't want that auto-archived, because I don't want folks to feel like they can't be open with what they want to talk about, because it's going to be preserved forever. So I think if I don't auto-archive, I can't highlight. That's my guess. But let us move on to the surprise. I do, though, I will say, I do upload all of these Apple Tuesdays to my YouTube account. So if you look on YouTube for KeyGlyph, you'll find my Apple Tuesday streams, you'll find a lot of my Twitch streams, you'll find all of the Sunday supplemental ongoing plays I've been doing with Zelda 2 and that I did with Undertale, and then other kind of weird stuff that I get up to. So you will definitely be able to see the footage there. So definitely check that out. It's unfortunate that I can't also archive on Twitch, but I weighed all of my options with all the things I wanted to do, and it wasn't in the cards. As long as your video is still on your channel, you believe that I can still highlight. I cannot do that myself right now, so it's a nice idea, but I think these things will have to live on YouTube. But we'll see. I'll look into it. But for now, here's our surprise. We're gonna go back to loading up our disk for DOS 3.3. This is our system master disk, which when booted in the computer gives us some extra functionality, so I'm gonna go ahead and do that now. I'm gonna reboot. Okay. DOS version 3.3, System Master, January 1st, 1983. So, I've explained before, but when you start your Apple II without a disk in the drive at all, you can actually basically escape to a command prompt, and you can program in AppleSoft Basic right there, and kind of have a sandbox to play in. But if you put in the System Master disk first, then anything that you work on here, you can actually save to a disk for later use. You can load things that have been programmed and so on. And we have something to ProDOS. We have something to load from our very special Apple IIsday disk, where I've been saving programs that folks have been programming to showcase on the stream. So far, Brigand has been our programmer. And you may remember the fighting game that we saw the other week, a couple weeks ago. Well, Brigand has added to it. So, we are going to run that, and any of you who want to get in on this battle royale can do so. And I've added my own extra element to it. If I can untangle my headphones, because I have to put these on now. Give me 1 second. Why can't I untangle headphones? I can never do this. These twisty things, I just can't. They get locked around each other, and then I just don't know what I'm doing. I just don't know what I'm doing. But Brigand, if you want to explain your game a little bit, whatever you feel like you want to share, go ahead. You don't have to reveal anything that you don't want to. But I have to put my headphones on for my contribution, so that I can monitor this. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. You're getting there. Hey, Rooney Gamer. Welcome, welcome. How you doing? Yes, so Brigand has programmed a fighting game where we get to enter in people's names and have them do battle. And what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to play music while the battles go on. I have a short little playlist of fighting game tunes, and I will randomize them for each battle. 8-bit and, well, I think they're all 16-bit tunes, actually. So 16-bit tunes, only from a handful of games. But this is what we're going to do. So we're going to go ahead, I put in his disc, and I'm going to... Actually, I'll show you this too, because this is kind of neat. If you type in catalog, it will show you everything that's on the disk that's currently in your drive. So we've got fighting version 1.1, version 1, and version 1.2. So we're going to load fighting version 1.2. Oh, thanks for dropping that, Brigand. I was going to ask you to do that, by the way. Because if any of you are interested in this stuff, if you know AppleSoft Basic or you want to see how this is all working, if you're just interested in looking at the code, I would love you all to be able to do that. And right, and Brigand is saying, feel free to look or mess around with it, which is really nice. So play, and share code amongst yourselves. But we have now loaded fighting version 1.2 into memory, so we're just going to go ahead and run it. So, who are our first combatants going to be? Who wants to fight? I should actually have like a choose your character tune. Hang on a second here. Let's do this. This will be good because this will kind of get me making sure everything's working properly here. Can you all hear that? That volume level okay? Let me add another one here. Okay, so let's see, what do we got here? Enron wants to be in there. Emily versus Snood. I want you guys to battle. What? Well, we can do a warm-up with me. We'll do a warm-up with me, and then Noozle is gonna be V somebody. But why don't we try this? So we'll do Key is player one, and then Snood is player two. So let me randomize a tune up in here. Ba-ba. You can hear this, right? Here we go. Yeah. No. Oh, right back at you, Snood. Wow, 2 damage from a piano? I'm a tank. A lot of pianos being wrecked in this battle. I'm just shrugging off all the pianos. Yeah! I win with 14 health left. Go home and be a family man, Snood. Alright. Da da da! So, we can do the rolling matches like we did last time, so why don't I roll into the next battle? Kitsurito says, I imagine the fighter is circled by baby grands. It's exactly what it was. It's like a combination fighting game and beat 'em up where you can just pick up everything. But how cool is that, everyone? So if you saw Brigand's last version of this is super expanded, and we've got different events for like different damages that are done, and there are multipliers and stuff. It's just so awesome. And yes, that's true. And Brigand mentioned something that was so cool in the code, which is that you don't always start with player one throwing the first blow. Each game running will randomly select whether the first player or the second player is going to throw the first strike. And feel free to just keep explaining more about it if you like, Brigand, because this is so cool. So let's do a couple of these, and then we'll push you all into another stream. But this is so fun. And if you folks like this, Brigand, don't feel like you have to keep updating it or anything like that, but we can do this at the end of the stream just for fun, every so often if we want to. And if anyone else wants to program some stuff, get some code going and share it, let me know, because I would love to showcase this stuff. Oh, Brigand, so the next tier is me, since I won. I'm going to go against Enron, and then the winner of that will go against Brigand. How about that? So let's do it. Let's run this again. Oh. Run. Key. Versus. Noozle, right? Oh, let's not put that in all capitals. Here we go. Randomize. Oh, let's just listen to a new character select for a moment. I have to be cognizant that the Genesis isn't too loud in comparison to the SNES. So we've chosen our characters, and let's get a tune going. Ready? And I can tell you all what these tracks are if you want to know. Here we go. Yes, Brigand, Eternal Champions. I'm just shrugging off all the pianos right now. Oh no, Noozle! Come on, get in a big hit. Get in a big hit. Oh, I win! With a piano drop. I continue. Isn't this so funny? The sense of humor is so great. Oh, here we go. Key wins! Alright, so now, me. Oh, let's do... I only have the two player selects, so I apologize for not having as much variation there, but I will build out... I will build out the music selections for sure. Oh, well, thanks for being in, Capsule J. Have a great night. Alright, here we go. Kitsarito says, little did the opponent know, Key trained in the mountains with the piano master. Key versus Brigand, yeah? This is us now, right? Do you want to just be Brigand? It's my idol animation. Try fighting Billy Joel. Okay, he's the piano man. Oh, Gunstar Green, have a great night. Have a good sleep. Thank you for being in and making me laugh in the chat, as always. Alright, random tune. Oh, snap. Go. M. Bison up in here. Oh, piano back in my face. This is a tight one. This is tight. Oh, we are match for match right now. Punch for punch, block for block. Oh, I slipped. My punch wasn't quite on target there. I used the light punch instead of the hard punch. Should have gone full. Brigand swings the master sword! Oh, I'm hanging on by the skin of my teeth right now. Oh, Brigand wins! Because Brigand had the Master Sword! I've been sent home to be a family man. Well done, Brigand. Well done. I want you all to see all, like, the cool little things that he put in. You know, like the Master Sword. Like, I know it's there because I typed this in. Let me show you the code, actually. This is the new expanded code, and it spills over a little bit onto the next page here. But yeah, beefed up from last time. It was already great, and it's just gotten better. Does anyone want to step up and fight Brigand? Want to get a couple more matches in before we move on? What do we think? Let's do one more match. Let's see if anyone can take out Brigand before we go. One more. This is from Ninja Turtles Tournament Fighters for the Sega Genesis, by the way. One of my favorite soundtracks of all time. Da, da, da. Wana. Kitsarito! Oh, Simon's up. So we don't know, so the TMNT Tournament Fighters music is in the mix, but we haven't hit any yet. It's Kitsarito versus Brigand, and then we'll do one more. We'll do one more with Simon, and I'll give you a a Tournament Fighters tune, how about? Let's do it. And then we'll move on. This is just too much fun. Brigand. V. Kitsarito. Players are selected. Random tune. More Street Fighter 2. Here we go. Oh, Kitarito opens up with a miss, but drops a piano for more damage. It was a larger piano. Piano, 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 another piano! Guys! Where are we getting all these entities? Where are we getting all these pianos? Brigand has set fire to the piano. Oh, Brigand wins with the Master Sword again. Someone's got to get that Master Sword away from that guy. Good showing, though, Kitarito. Good showing. All right. Last one. Simon, do you just want to be Simon? Brigand versus Simon. What do you think? Simon will do. Okay, Tournament Fighter's Tune. Let's do it. Here we go. Go! Pianos, fire. Pianos again. Simon is just like doing just straight up regular attacks. Brigand swings and misses! Simon's like, I don't need fancy moves. I just kick. Look at this. Simon's like, I don't even need items to fight you. Simon swings and misses too. Oh no, oh no. Da 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 da. Oh schnip, Simon. Brigand wins by dropping a piano! Brigand is the champion of the night. Holy smokes. How much fun is that? Oh, sorry. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Simon says, okay, maybe I should have used a special or two. You guys are too funny. Isn't that fun? Oh, we have to listen to it again. Da-da-da-da-da. All right, folks, this has been a lovely stream tonight. Let me go ahead and push you all into someone else's stream. Thank you all for playing along. So much fun. And let's see. Let's see, let's see, let's see. What do we got? What do we got? What do we got? What do we got? And of course, Brigand, thank you so much for doing the programming and making such a fun game. Really, really fun. Really fun. All right, who we got here? What is the Renaissance doing right now? The Renaissance is doing Space Quest 1. Nudes of Dudes is doing more Elder Scrolls. Alright. I know I keep pushing you into the Renaissance. But why don't we do it? Space Quest? I think this is his first time playing a Space Quest game, if I remember correctly. So I'm going to get this raid going. Thank you all for spending time with me. Have a lovely night. Oh, what are we asking me? Asking me? There's no line or two that favors any player named Brigand. And Brigand is just like, don't ask me. Ask Key. All right, folks. Have a lovely night. I will see you on Thursday for some kind of retro game situation. Probably going to be Thunder Force 3. And Sunday, more Zelda 2 progress. And of course, next Tuesday, Apple Tuesday. So, have a great night. Take care, everybody. And thanks for getting me reelected.